I wanted to look at the concept of a freedom that was mentioned by others. And it reminds me of this song that we sing often, the cup song. We call it the cup song, Dror Yikra. Dror Yikra, and in, you know, it says, Dror Yikra Levenim Bat, Yinsorchem Kemo Vavat. And this is about, it says, in if you translate into English, it talks about how Hashem grants freedom, Dror, to son and daughter. And it's talking about the Shabbat day and how Shabbat is that freedom. It's one, it's the freedom that he gives us. He says, you don't have to toil, you know, 7 days a week. You can rest once a week, and you don't have to worry about your sustenance. I will provide for you. And it's the same thing with the Shemitah and the Jubilee, when slaves are released. And this, the Shabbat is, these Shabbats are a taste of the world to come. In Judaism, we say that there will be a Yom Shekulo Shabbat, a day that is all Shabbat. There's nothing but rest and cessation, rest from sin, rest from oppression, rest from slavery, rest from idolatry, rest from suffering and pain, all those things. And this is the Messianic era. But it won't come without tribulation. It says in the Talmud, Sanhedrin 97a, our rabbis taught, in the 7 years of the Son of David's coming, in the first year, the verse from Amos 4:7 that says, I would send rain on one city, and on another city I would not send rain, will be fulfilled. In the second, the arrows of hunger will be sent forth. In the third, a great famine, during which men, women, infants, the devout, and men of deeds will die. And the Torah will be forgotten by her students. In the fourth, plenty and no plenty. In the fifth, great plenty, when men will eat, drink, and rejoice, and the Torah will return to its disciples. In the sixth, voices or noises. In the seventh, wars. And at the end of the seven, the Son of David will come. Rabbi Yosef objected, but many such sevens have passed, yet he has not come. Abaye replied, was there ever voices, noises in the sixth year and wars in the seventh? Have such troubles ever come in this order? So he's saying it's going to come in this exact order. Is it going to come true exactly like that? I don't know. But in Christian eschatology, there's also a very similar, you know, understanding that there's going to be 7 years of tribulation before Mashiach comes, and then at the end he will come. I didn't know before that was also in Judaism, that was also part of Talmud. Anyways, regarding Yovel and freeing the slaves, I think this is an issue that a lot of secular people have with the Bible, because many evil men have used the Bible and their own corrupt understanding of it to justify oppressive slavery. Now, the word slavery, or in Hebrew, it is avadim, so slaves. That's usually translated as slaves or slavery. Eved is a slave, and we say that every morning. You know, thank God that He has not made me a slave. But that word eved, it could mean slave, it could mean servant, and it can also mean worshiper, because our word for worship is also that same root. We say avodah zarah is foreign worship, right? That's the kind of worship we don't want to do for the foreign gods. But, you know, worship of the one true God is also called avodah. So it's all a matter, I believe, you know, is it slavery or is it worship? You know, it's the same word. And I think it all, what it depends on, what it comes down to, is who are you serving? If you are serving a benevolent, mighty creator who takes care of you, you know, who treats you like his son or daughter, then it's worship, right? It's respect, it's honor. We serve because we love him and he protects us, et cetera, et cetera. It is servanthood when we are serving someone for For some kind of equal pay, right? That is the worthy of the service that we're providing. And then on the other extreme, we are slaves when the person that we are serving is wicked and cruel, oppressive, and does not give us what is fair and just. All the same word. It's more of a matter of perspective. But it's not only has to do with who we're serving, it also has to do with the servant or the worshiper or the slave. Are we appreciative? Do we want to be under that rule? Or do we feel like the authority that we're under is like slavery? So, you know, there are some people who believe that the Torah is burdensome, that the Torah is oppressive, unjust, et cetera, et cetera. And so to them, they don't feel like worshipers, reverent. They feel more like slaves to the Torah. And that is more about your attitude, your perspective to whom you are serving. You know, same thing with at work, or maybe you're part of a family, you know. How do you see yourself? You know, is it your perspective, or is there true oppression that's going on? And could things be changed simply by changing your thoughts about your situation? Could your life be better by appreciating the boundaries and the guidelines and the structure, the framework that you have been put in this life? Because Kabbalah teaches us that everything was meant to be, and there's some Kabbalists that even believe that before we came down to earth, our souls chose what parents we would come through to be born through, and what family we would end up being in. And that whatever, even if that wasn't necessarily, you know, a good situation that we chose to be in, that there was something in that situation that our souls chose, that our souls needed to grow and to fulfill its destiny. Anyways, another thing that I wanted to point out is also that that the Torah is a very tribal religion. This is not an individualistic religion like Christianity is. Christianity is like, I mean, maybe not all Christianity, maybe not historical Christianity, I'm not sure. But today, in my experience, Christianity has been taught to be a very individualistic religion. Your relationship is between you and God and no one else. Church is good, but optional, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Judaism is quite the opposite. We were called as a nation to serve God, not just as individuals. Abraham was called not as an individual either. He brought his whole tribe with him, right? His whole family with him. And the welfare system in the Torah, it has to do with family, right? Just like Ruben was saying, you have to help your family first. And when someone falls into hard times, it's your family members, it's your kinsman redeemer, your family, your relative, that is obligated to come and help you. Which is why even though Abraham and Lot, they didn't get along with each other very well, but when Lot was in danger, Abraham went to save him. And Abraham was chosen, it says, because Hashem knew that he would teach his children to follow God's commandments and statutes and judgments. The very first commandment is to be fruitful and multiply. That is the commandment to create a family, to create children. Jewish law says you have to have one male and one female. Someone said, I think it was Nathaniel saying, is that why some Jews have a lot? Because they only have one sex, one gender, and then they keep trying till they get the other. I'm like, yeah, maybe. Was it Nathaniel or so? One of them. Okay, yeah. I was like, yeah, I think so. But in the Shema, which is considered the greatest commandment, it says that we are to teach our children these words which Hashem commanded us, which refers to the Shema primarily, but it also refers to the whole Torah, that we should teach these words. This is the greatest commandment. It's not just love God. You know, someone asked Yeshua, what is the greatest commandment? And he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. But within that commandment, what does it mean to love God? It means to teach your children to follow after God's commandments. And so that is one part of the greatest commandment. How do we love God? We teach our children to follow God's commandments. This is our greatest calling, is to make disciples. But that doesn't mean, as in Christianity, go look for other people outside. Doesn't mean we shouldn't do that. I'm not saying we shouldn't do that, but it starts in the home. It starts with within our family. And if you know me, I have a very strong hand when it comes to parenting. I discipline my children, and I demand respect. You know, to be honest, I demand respect. I demand respect for myself. I demand respect for each other, meaning I demand that my children respect each other as well. A lot of times children will come and they'll seek justice. Oh, he did this, she did that. You know, they want justice, and they want to be the rightest one, the most correct one, the one that deserves vindication. But I found that when I turn it around and I treat them as a collective whole, just like Hashem treats Israel, he does the same thing to us. He says, you all are punished collectively because what each of you do affects one another. When I treat them like that, I say, look, you all need to do this. And if you all don't do this, you all will be punished. I find that when I do that, the arguments cease. They get along with each other. They stop complaining because they understand that them individually trying to be vindicated helps no one, but instead cooperation and making sure that the group as a whole is healthy and well and doing the right thing, they change their tone. They change their tone with each other, because instead of saying, oh, you're not doing this and you're not doing that, they know that, oh, if I go up to complain, I'm gonna get in trouble. If we don't finish this job together, we're gonna all get in trouble. So they start speaking with each other nicely. They start doing what they can to encourage each other to do their part, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And Hashem does the same thing with us. We're not here just to judge each other, you know, and to point out flaws in one another. We can do that all day long, and there'll be no end to that, and there'll be no productivity to that. What we need to do is that if we see our brother falling, if we see our brother in need, we have to think about how can I help improve myself so that I can help improve him, so that we can all improve as a whole, as a people, as a congregation, as a family, etc. And I believe that's what Yeshua meant when he said, you know, if you see something in your brother's eye, first take the log out of your own eye, because if you don't, you won't know how to take the log out of your brother's eye. So when you see someone else doing something wrong, you have to think about, oh, let me go take their sin to the judge, and the judge will vindicate me. No, the judge will probably look at your sins. So that's not the right thing to do. The right thing to do is say, okay, I see my brother sinning. What's my sin? What's my sin? And how can I influence both myself and others to do better? That is the way. Of course, you know, if a brother sins against you, go to him in private, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But we can go above and beyond that. The other thing that I want to address is going back to slavery, which is that, you know, people use this Torah portion to justify slavery. But we see, you know, with the Garden of Eden, that slavery was not the ideal, and it was through sin that there were things such as multiple wives and slavery and other forms of injustice and unfairness. So just because something is allowed in the Torah, that doesn't mean that it is the ideal that we are supposed to strive to. And Rabbi Asher and others have pointed out that if someone converts to Judaism, their slavery, their period of slavery, is limited, right? Therefore, the sages set things up so that wicked people who became slaves were encouraged to transform and convert to Judaism so that they could have full freedom. And that is the wisdom of our sages, and that's one of the beauties of the Oral Torah, And you know, one of the reasons why it's good to understand Talmud and oral history, et cetera, et cetera. So, sure, there may be some things that we may disagree and we may find archaic and et cetera, et cetera. But there's also a lot of wisdom. And without some of the explanation of the sages, you know, people just throw off the Torah and they say, "Oh, that's archaic. These are vulgar laws. Something like that. These are base laws. We want something higher. We want the New Testament." You know, that's something that's been said in history. But no, if you have the proper understanding of it, which our sages have done through many Jewish texts, and I think it's a gift, a blessing that we as Jews have to, I'm not saying that the Torah is not enough, but it is a blessing that we have the recordings of the wisdom of our sages, of those who have studied the Torah before us, and how they have dissected the law and interpreted it to be applicable, to be loving, to be progressive, not in the liberal, you know, leftist kind of way, but in the good way, in progressive, true progress, leading closer and closer to godliness. So then why did Hashem allow slavery in the Torah? Well, because he works with us where we're at. Slavery was so pervasive, and it still is, actually. It still is today. Slavery is just as pervasive as it is today. They say there's more slaves or people who have been abducted today than ever before, partly because of the population growth, but it doesn't matter. There's more slaves today than there was back in the days of the Torah. And if they were treated with the same dignity that the Torah and the Talmud provided, it would be better, you know. However, I digress. Basically, Hashem, we don't think that there's slavery here in America, but there actually is. You know, we just outsource our slavery to poor countries, that's all, where they are very much mistreated. So the Torah still is applicable today in many ways.